Hello, and welcome to episode 4 of season 2 of Amiga Retro Games. Mine White Beer again, and as you saw from that little wonderful intro we saw there, the game we're covering in this episode is the epic Wing Commander game, done back in 1990. It's a great game, absolutely fantastic game, and it spawned off many a sequel. So what is it? Let's go straight into the game. Wing Commander, retroactively referred to as Wing Commander 1 or WC1, is the first eponymous game in the Chris Roberts science fiction simulator franchise. The game was released for MS-DOS and was later ported onto the Amiga, the Sega CD, the Super NES, as well as the 3DO. In August 2006, GameSpot also reported that EA will also be porting, or already has ported, the game, the Super NES version, to the PlayStation Portable as part of the EA Replay Pack. And it was actually released in the United States on November 14th, 2006. Anyway, back to the original. The game was released by Origin Systems in 1990. The game was a marked departure from the standard formula, bringing space combat to a level approaching that of the Star Wars film franchise. The game is set in the year 2654 and characterized by Chris Roberts as World War II in space. It featured a multinational cast of pilots from what in the game is known as the Terran Confederation, flying missions against the predatory aggressive race known as the Kilrathi. The Kilrathi are a feline warrior race. Most impressively, cockpit performance affected gameplay. Going above inside the game, for example, if you are flying in a mission and you go above and beyond the call of duty, results in medals, promotions in rank, on regular intervals, and success or failure on certain critical missions would even decide the player's story plot's progress, winning or losing. In other words, depending on how well you did, depending on how the actual story played out. So, let's have a look at the plot synopsis, shall we? The player takes the role of a nameless pilot aboard the TCS Tiger's Claw, a Bengal-class strike cruiser. The player gets to name the pilot and choose, obviously, his call sign. The pilot, known to the production staff at Origin as Blue Hair, after his most notable feature, quickly rises through the ranks of the flight wing, and presuming, of course, that the player's performance ideally in the cockpit, eventually goes on to lead the strike on the Kilrathi High Command Starbase in the Venice system. On the other hand, if the player does not perform optimally, missions become increasingly defensive in nature, and eventually the Tiger's Claw is forced to retreat. So it depends, like I say, how you do on your missions and how the story plot forces out, you know, plays out. Of the two endings, the winning path is established as canon by the game's two expansion packs, as well as the sequel, Wing Commander 2: Vengeance of the Kilrathi. In 1994. Wing Commander was retroactively renamed to Wing Commander 1 in a bundled re-release of both games in preparation for the release of Wing Commander 3: Heart of the Tiger. The rebundled remakes, however, do not contain and do not support the Secret Missions add-on pack, which was also released. Now, what is the Secret Missions add-on pack? Well, it was an add-on campaign from Origin, most notable for being one of the first expansion packs in video gaming history. It required Wing Commander 1 software to run, but adds new missions, new ships, a new storyline, and an increase in difficulty level. The game was also released for the Super NES as a standalone cartridge. Now, the story plot behind the expansion pack is as follows. The Tiger's Claw is on manoeuvres in the Goddard system, receives an abortive distress call from Goddard Colony. When the call arrives, though, nothing is left but wreckage and corpses. A quarter of a million colonists have been killed. Confed realizes that this is the work of a new Kilrathi weapon, the Graviton weapon, which is able to increase the power of gravity by 100 times fold. Clever work by the Tiger's Claw's crew and pilots allow them to capture the Kilrathi courier ship, which reveals that the weapon is mounted on an entirely new class of ship. Command and control codenames it the Sivar class dreadnought. After the Kilrathi god of war, Blue Hair leads a strike against the Sivar and destroys it in the Vigrid system. For unexplained reasons, though, ships of that class and armament are never ever seen again in any of the Wing Commander series games. Now, that's just a brief synopsis there to the Secret Missions add-on pack. Unlike the original game, though, Secret Missions does not feature a branching mission tree. Every player plays the same missions in the same order. However, if the player does not fulfill the mission requirements at any system, he immediately plays the two losing retreat missions that are not on the winning path. There was a sequel to the Secret Missions as well. They called it Secret Missions 2 Crusade, which I won't go into any detail for because it's not really, it's just a story plot on this. Super Wing Commander. Let's go on to the next thing here. Super Wing Commander was released in 1994 for the 3DO and was a drastic new look at the events of the original Wing Commander game with enhanced graphics and full speech, instead of just text this time. The game also contained both secret missions and a special third campaign which was also created between them called Secret Mission 1.5. It was done by the fans actually, and it was actually bundled with it. And that mission led the Tiger's Claw to track down and destroy the shipyards responsible for creating the Sivar Dreadnought in the first place. Additionally, background element rumours about stealth fighters and Admiral Tolwyn were added to improve the continuity, get my wording right there, with Wing Commander 2. Now, the development side of Wing Commander, let's have a look at this here. Wing Commander was actually shipped with an instruction booklet styled as a shipboard magazine. Claw marks. It provided tactical suggestions, statistics on fighters and weapons, both Kilrathi and Terran, capsule biographies of notable pilots on both sides of the line, and general shipboard news, such as the discontinuation of the popular comic strip Hornet's Nest due to the recent death of its artist, Lieutenant Larry Tuna Dibbles, who was a character in the game. It is the source of most of the following information that I'm about to read you. Notable contributions to Clawmarks magazine include Captain Aaron Alice Alston, Major Warren Spector, and Colonel Chris Roberts. Original names. You can tell developers love getting the kick out of putting their own names in there. Anyway, the Confederation pilots for Wing Commander. Obviously, there's Blue Hair, and he's also known as Christopher Maverick Blair. Full name established in Wing Commander 3, Heart of the Tiger, but up until that point, he was just known as Blue Hair, but he's called Christopher Blair. Anyway. Blessed with very little dialogue, Blair nods and smiles his way through the game. Later materials established that his rebellious call sign was given to him as an ironic reference to his by-the-book flying style. We also had people like Captain Jeanette Devereaux, otherwise known as Angel. You've probably seen her in the video here. An elegant Belgian with an unfortunate habit of spouting statistics on enemy and allied craft. She's great for information, but not so for her parties. There's a whole list of them. You know, you've got things like Marco Spirit. You know, Spirit, he's a Japanese pilot. You've got Maniac Marshall, etc., etc. Paladin, Iceman, you know, all the different characters that you interact with throughout the game, and also have the opportunity at some point throughout the game to fly with, if you do well. Now, one thing to know about Wing Commander on the Amiga is it was one of the few games. I mean, everybody who owns a Nintendo Game Boy, DS, or even the more modern-day consoles that use System Link. Well, the Amiga and a few of the PCs, actually, they weren't, those consoles and stuff weren't the first to have them. It wasn't groundbreaking news having a System Link cable, because the Amiga could do it, as well as a few other platforms as well. If you had two Amiga 500s, for example, or an Amiga 500 and Amiga 600, yeah, and you wanted to play with your friend, you bundled your Amiga up, took it round to your mate's house, got a lat link cable, which is like a parallel port link cable, or a serial link cable, plugged it into both computers, started the game on both, and then you could play two-player. You could fly against each other. It was actually possible to fly against each other using two computers at that time. I know that because I used to play it with my uncle quite often when I first started playing this game, many, many moons ago. So it was not only was it one of the first games to actually introduce expansion packs, it also was one of the few games that were actually playable via Laplink, or System Link, as now referred to. Very crude type of connection, but nonetheless, it worked, and it worked fine. Hardly ever crashed on you. Now, obviously the Wing Commander series has gone on to, you know, make numerous sequels with, you know, famous actors in it like Mark Hamill, and also they made the film with, I think, had Freddie Prinze Jr. in it, and David Suchet, and, what's his name? The guy who played, I can't remember the actor's name, the guy who plays Shaggy in Scooby-Doo, and, you know, and stuff like that. He was playing Maniac, and I think also in one of the actual full-motion video games, the guy who plays Biff Tannen from Back to the Future also played Maniac in those games. So, the game franchise has gone on from strength to strength, but unfortunately died off. It has died off over time, you know. I don't think many people have seen it, but it does have a huge underground following. There isn't really much more to say about it. Aside from the fact that if you do want a PSP, you can get it on EA's Replay. You can obviously get it as a download from the net for ADF and some of the abandonware stuff for this original game by Origin. But yeah, there you go. Wing Commander, the 3D space combat simulator, released in 1990 by Origin Systems, was designed by Chris Roberts, and even though actually it says it's single player, it was possible with the Amiga to play as multiplayer. And there you go. Watch that. Let you enjoy the end of this footage, and I'll see you in episode 5. Till then, take care.